In the name of Christ our Lord, I welcome you to this time of worship and invite you to take a few moments to prepare your hearts to worship God together.
Here in this time of worship, we thank God for this day and for all the days since the beginning of creation. We celebrate God's gift to us on this beautiful spring day, and may our awareness of God's presence in us be deepened. May our hearts and minds be open to what God is about to do in us, in word, song, and spirit. Will you join with us in the responsive call to worship? Praise God, all peoples.
Praise God, all creation.
Whales doing backflips in the air. Squid and octopi dancing on the ocean floor.
Giant redwoods stretching to the sky. Tomato vines cuddling around a steak.
Mountains blocking the sunrise. Moles tunneling through our front lawns. Five-year-olds sitting in a storytime circle. Grandparents singing their song, roses flourishing in the backyards, grass growing faster than our children,
seals getting a suntan on the rocks. Teenagers knotted together in small groups, keeping safe distance and wearing masks.
Praise God, all creation.
Praise God, all peoples.
Beautiful and good, celebrate in parable and story, holiness in glory, living, loving God. Hail and Hosanna, bring many names, strong Mother God. Night and day, planning all the wonders of creation, setting each equation, genius at play. Hail and Hosanna, strong Mother God, great living God.
We show others who we are by the lives we lead, the words we speak, the actions we undertake. Let us confess how we have not been God's little children when we fail to love as we have been loved. Please join in prayer, first in silence and then together. And now let us pray together.
Who are we to get in your way, Holy God?
We put people into neat little boxes, but you rip them open so folks can dance in your joy. We imprison others with our unmet expectations, and you set them free with a word. We build walls around those we don't know, and you tear them down. So that they can run wild in the kingdom.
Who are we to get in your way, saving God, especially in the way of your forgiveness offered to all? Give us your vision that sees everyone as equal, forgiven, graced, and loved, even as we seek to follow our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We know who God is by the love shown to us in Christ Jesus. We will show others who we are and whose we are by the love poured out by our lives. Thanks be to God. We are forgiven. Amen. Amen.
Glory to God, gloria in excelsis Deo. Gloria, gloria, alleluia, alleluia. Gloria, gloria in excelsis Deo.
So we now open our hearts and our minds to the grace that God desires to pour into our lives this day as we listen for the Spirit's leading in the Scriptures. Join your hearts with me in prayer. O God, be now our vision as you help us heal our brokenness. When you wipe away our tears, you show us your creation. Brother Jesus, when you hang out with the world's outcasts, and when you stay a little longer with those we rush past, you show us the new earth. Holy Spirit, as death comes our way, when our mourning becomes a memory, you show us the new heaven. So be with us now, Mothering God, as we need your comfort and your care. Amen. There are two scripture readings for today, one from the book of Revelation and one from the Gospel of John. The book of Revelation speaks about the new heaven and the new earth about to come. Listen now for what the Holy One speaks to your life today. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "See, the home of God is among mortals. God will dwell with them. They will be God's peoples, and God will be with them, will wipe every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more, for the first things have passed away." And the one who is seated on the throne said, "See, I am making all things new." And he also said, "Write this, for these words are trustworthy and true." And then from the Gospel of John, reading from chapter 13, verses 31 to 35. When he had gone out, Jesus said, "Now the Son of Man has been glorified, and God has been glorified in him. If God had been glorified in him, God will also glorify him in himself, and will glorify him at once. Little children, I am with you only a little longer. You will look for me, and as I said to the Jews, so now I say to you, where I am going, you cannot come. I give you a new commandment, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you should also love one another. And by this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another." This ends the readings for today. May God bless them to our understanding and deepen our faith through them. Thanks be to God. Amen.
whether you are 92 or 52 or 12, close your eyes just for a moment and remember when you first held a baby in your arms. Remember the first time when you looked into that child's eyes, a small little miracle in and of herself. Whether it was your first or your last, or not one of your own making, remember the moment. Now open your eyes and remember the scriptures. See, I make all things new. And Jesus says, love one another as I have loved you. Motherhood, fatherhood, parenthood is an amazing experience. What's also amazing is what people will say or do to a pregnant woman. How a complete stranger will approach you and put a hand on your belly. Or someone will come up to you and ask if you know whether it's going to be a boy or a girl. Or worse yet, they tell you what gender your child is going to be. Reverend Agnes Norfleet tells of a time when she was pregnant. And she was buying vegetables at the local farmer's market. A woman approached her and said, is this your first child? No, I have a boy who's almost two, Agnes replied. And then the woman said, not with a smile, but a grave expression, how can you dare to bring children into this cruel and terrible world? Our world has never been completely safe for children, but there is a certain sadness in knowing that even the world I grew up in was safer than the world in which our children are being born today. As a little girl, I had free rein of my neighborhood, including a big field where we played ball, a wooded area where we built forts. I could pedal my bike as far as my legs would take me. Only one time, a car pulled over when I was riding my bike and stopped. The man rolled down the window. The man had no pants on and asked me to get in his car. But no one ever came into a child's bedroom and abducted her at a slumber party. In fact, in my day, we kept the doors unlocked night and day. As a teenager, I tried alcohol and threw up. I heard about drugs, but was too scared to take them. But what I realize now is that our children today have more freedom. I'm sorry, less freedom and more exposure than we could ever imagine. Our world today is indeed a dangerous place for children. And God said, and death will be no more. Tears and crying will be no more. In the spring of 1995, I remember talking with a member of my congregation about being deeply moved by the commemorations of the end of World War II, which at that point was 50 years. It's actually tomorrow, 76 years since V-Day. Many of the members of my church had served in that war. And this man said he remembered hearing on a program that commemorated the date that the victory in Europe was the last time we really felt good about ourselves as a nation. There was this sense that with the fall of Hitler and the German forces, that a powerful evil had been eradicated, defeated. The war was over, he said, and we rejoiced. Back in 1995, we watched the celebrations of that 50th anniversary, and a new memorial was erected in Washington, D.C. to honor those veterans. Yet we watched with a certain anxiety, certain dread about today's world. In black and white newsreels, we saw footage of concentration camps freed And in living color on the evening news, we have watched as men and women have been tortured and abused in the Middle East. In black and white documentaries, we were shown beleaguered Russian troops stumbling home in the mud. And in living color on the evening news, September 11th, 2001, we watched in shock as the Twin Towers were blown to bits and watched bodies falling through the air. In black and white, the American and French soldiers partied down the Champs-Élysées, and in living color, we watched protests for peace, Black Lives Matter, people rallying for freedom throughout the world. Maybe all of us, parents and grandparents and would-be parents, should ask ourselves, how dare we bring children into this cruel and terrible world? Because it's so hard not to be horrified at the abuse of prisoners by our own hand. Soldiers who feel they can't come home because they have such humiliation. And too many, way too many, resulting in PTSD, mental illness, or suicide. Yet the children we have brought into this world, this terrible and cruel world, are the very ones who have been fighting in these wars. What's worse, in my mind, they still are children. I read an article in Time magazine on the teenage brain, which says in part, the very last part of the brain to be shaped to its adult dimensions is the home of the so-called executive functions, planning, suppressing impulses, weighing the consequences of one's actions. Our children, who have been trained to fight, destroy, and likely have been humiliated by their own trainers, the very ones who may have learned when they were 5 or 6, there are two kinds of love, God's love and our love. But God made both kinds of them. Our scripture readings this morning find us in an era of uncertainty, a sort of in-between time. In the Gospel of John, Jesus is giving yet another farewell instruction to his confused disciples before his departure. They cling to him as if hanging on for dear life. Little children, Jesus says, I am only with you a little longer. You will look for me. Where I am going, you cannot come. And then he tells them how to live when he leaves. Love one another, just as I have loved you. Like the veteran who told me, those disciples may have wondered if this would be the last time that they would feel good about themselves as a community. But Jesus was trying to let them know that the end of his life would inaugurate the beginning of a new creation. Author James Baldwin wrote, one must say yes to life and embrace it wherever it is found. And it is found in terrible places. For nothing is fixed forever and forever and forever. It is not fixed. The earth is always shifting. The light is always changing. The sea does not cease to grind down rock. Generations do not cease to be born. And we are responsible to them because we are the only witnesses they have. The sea rises, the light fails. Lovers cling to each other, and the children cling to us. The moment we cease to hold each other, the moment we break faith with one another, the sea engulfs us and the light goes out. Even though I am leaving, Jesus said to his disciples, don't break faith with one another. Hold fast together in love. We too, and still, live in an in-between time between the departure of Jesus' earthly ministry and the fulfillment of God's new creation. We see Jesus, who taught us how to live, who showed us how to love, and who promised us a new life in his name. And we hear the words from Revelation, which, by the way, are not offered in the future perfect tense, but in the present tense. Now, see, I am making all things new. In this cruel and terrible world, Jesus' call is to us to see things differently than the way they are. How do we love like Jesus loved? I think about 3 years ago, in addition to Lucy, we had another young family, Sunny and her two daughters, Juniper and Poppy. The three girls were all seated around the art table working on their coloring pages. It was the time in service for joys and concerns. And one church member stood up to ask for prayers, and she started to cry. And she kept crying, crying so hard that she couldn't finish her prayer. She sat down. Juniper stood up from the art table, her brow furrowed in concern. And she walked over to the woman who was still crying, and Juniper put her head and her arms on the woman's lap. When I talked to her at coffee hour, I asked Juniper why she had done that, and she said, "I just helped her cry." Throughout the book of Revelation, God is pictured as mysterious, majestic, victorious. But in this reading today, God wipes away every tear from our eyes, just like Juniper did. This is the great promise that the pain of this world will be overcome. Our future is cradled in the care and concern and comfort of God's love. How dare we bring children into this terrible and cruel world? By seeing the world through the children's eyes and holding fast to the vision and promise of what the world is yet to be. Like a little child in her mother's arms, so is my soul with God. Like a little child in her mother's arms, so is my soul with God. May it be so. Amen. Our special offering for the month of May is Westminster Woods, our wonderful camp and conference center in the Redwoods. I've been to retreats there, led retreats there, both for youth and women's groups. They have a wonderful environmental and ecology program now open to the wider community. Please read the information in today's program. Now, if you will join me in the prayer of dedication. Thank you, gracious God, for making your home with us and claiming us as your people. We dedicate ourselves and our gifts toward the new world you are creating among us, a world where peace emerges from mutual respect and love. May your love be reflected in all we say and do. Amen.
And oh, my soul so weary, when troubles come and my heart burden me, then I am still and wait here in the silence until you come and sit a while with me. You raise me up so I can stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on stormy seas. I am strong when I am on your shoulders. You raise me up to more than I can be. There is no life, no life without its hunger. Each restless heart beats so imperfectly. But when you come and I am filled with wonder, sometimes I think I glimpse eternity. You raise me up so I can stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on stormy seas. I am strong when I am on your shoulders. You raise me up to more than I can be.
This is the time in our service when we lift up our prayers for the world around us, our children, parents, grandparents, everyone, our friends. If you have a special request, I ask that you hold that in your heart, and when we gather together during fellowship hour, you might express those concerns. Please join me in prayer. God, most high and holy, maker of earth and heaven, we praise you for your creative power and fierce like a mother's love. Giver of life, you are our peace and wisdom. You are our joy and justice. You are our beauty and gentleness. All glory, honor, and thanksgiving be unto you. Heavenly Father, mother of us all, we thank you for calling us together into this household of faith. We thank you for mothers, grandmothers, and ancient foremothers in the faith. God of our children and grandchildren, we entrust to you the members of our families, both near and far, living and dead, and pray that you will keep them, body and spirit, in your loving care. We pray for your healing presence to help those families who suffer hunger and homelessness, who seek refuge from violence and oppression, who are trapped in poverty, who are torn apart by bitterness, hurt, or betrayal. Draw near to every family under stress. Teach us trust and tolerance for one another. Teach us mutual respect, fidelity, and patience. Open our eyes, Creator God, to our kinship with the whole of creation, and to our relatedness with all people around the world. May we be family, God, with each other and with the earth. Strengthen and inspire us, O strong and gentle one, that we might better serve you, each other, and the world you love so much. We pray together now the prayer that Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen.
Joy and the love of the Lord, we are called to be light for the kingdom, to live in the freedom of the city of God. We are blessed. We are called to love tenderly. We are called to serve one another, to walk humbly with God. Sing our new song. Sing of that great day when all will be one. God will reign and we'll walk with each other as sisters and brothers, united in love. We are called to act with justice. We are called to love tenderly. We are called to serve one another, to walk humbly with God.
And so, my friends, life is short. There's so little time to walk this journey with others. So be kind, kinder than is necessary. Love one another with all your heart and all your strength and all your mind, as Jesus loved you. And now may the God who created you in God's own image bless you this day. May the God who redeemed you, our Lord Jesus the Christ, hold you and care for you in your every need. And may the Holy Spirit that abides within you move you forward to do acts of justice and love. In Christ's name, amen.